I'm sure you all know why you're here today, just to thank God for the life of Leonard. To thank God for all the kids, for Leonard, Lorraine, for Kathy, for John, for the extended family, and we're going to have one of the grandchildren speaking today. But we're here to thank God for the life of Eric Morland Limpus. Now, I didn't know Eric, but I've spoken to some members of the family, and I'll be able to pass on those thoughts today. And then the family will be able to speak more particularly about Eric's life. Let me just pray. Father, we just commit this time to you today. I thank you, Lord, for the peace of God that passes understanding, that you won for us, Lord, through coming amongst us and through dying for us and rising from the dead. But Lord, as we look to you today, we can have the peace to know that there is somebody in charge. Lord, down here, lots of crazy things happen. It's the time of loss and grief today. But Lord, in this context of loss and grief, I pray, Lord, you'll help us to be friends to one another. And Lord God, you use us to convey your peace to each other. And I pray, Lord, that that peace and your presence might be here today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me just read for you a passage. And it comes from John chapter 14. This was just before Jesus was crucified. And it's recorded in John 14, 1-6. He says this, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, you believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." And Thomas, he's a doubter at this stage in his life, he said to Jesus, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." They're exceptional words just before his own death. And they are words of great comfort and hope. Let me share some thoughts generally about Eric's life. He was born in 1927 at Bondi Junction to English migrants. Now, I have this from the family. He grew up in Bondi in the same family house until 1972. Now, before 1972, Eric had married Irene in 1949. He moved to Wheeler Heights with Irene in 1972, and he lived in Wheeler Heights for the rest of his life, virtually. That was the family home for him. He only went into the nursing home last December. Now, this church was chosen by the family because of its stonework. The stonework used to be the original building, and now it's been extended. But the house in Bondi Junction, that was stone as well. So that's why the building was chosen here today. Now, I talked to Leonard, and Leonard just shared a few things with me. He said Dad was placid, he had a long fuse, he was approachable. I'll read these different thoughts with you, and there'll be a lot of overlapping, but you'll get the picture, and then the family will come out, and Leonard especially will come out and speak more particularly. Placid, long fuse, approachable. He would talk calmly, quietly, not one to boast, went about his life quietly, inquisitive, thorough, a man of detail, dry sense of humour, witty even in pain towards the end. Like I said once to Leonard, something you just got to put up with. Didn't let things rattle him. He had a Zephyr, I remember those cars when I was a teenager, and that Zephyr is still in good nick today apparently, which says something about Eric's life. He's a man who was particular and looked after things. He's very deliberate. He looked after things. He was moderate. Lorraine said he was calm, cool, and collected. And Kathy said to me, her dad was a quiet, gentle man, but reserved. A big homebody. Deeply committed to his wife Irene when she was here with him. He's a bit cheeky at times, spoke his mind. Not that diplomatic either sometimes. He said what he regarded as the truth. He was deliberate in all he did, devoted to his 11 grandchildren. And he also had a good sense of humour and gave the family lots of laughs. And Kathy said more to me, "Dad was a gentleman. who idolised his wife Irene. Irene once told Kathy that every time they arrived home in the Zephyr from an outing, he would always kiss her and open the door for her. Dad was a musician who loved playing the organ. Dad and Mum were members of the Organ Society. This was a social group where members took turns in hosting supper and playing their music. Dad always thought he hadn't practiced enough, but Mum would always build him up and coax him to play. He was an artist, and now I found out today he once sketched Irene on a matchbox, and when the sketch was blown up, it was almost identical to the detail of his wife. But he was an artist. In his younger days, he sketched with the lead pencil. He had an amazing talent that way. He could duplicate a person's face amazingly. He loved gardening, and he ensured that Mum had a say in what was planted, like azaleas and other plants with various shades of purple, because that was her favourite colour. He made sure he watered the garden before going to bed, even though it was with the aid of a torch and sometimes after midnight. So all those lovely little memories, they all come together. And what I'm going to do now, I'm going to get Leonard. Leonard, you come up and Leonard's going to talk, and then one of the grandchildren's going to speak as well. So why don't we do that now? So Leonard, you come up and give the eulogy. And then Emily's going to say a few words too. Okay.
I don't know what to say now. Campbell did that very well.
I just repeat, you've got all the details because it's from your heart, really and truly.
I wish to acknowledge everyone present here today, friends of Pa. I'm going to call him Pa because there's more people call him Pa than call him Dad. You've outnumbered us. So Pa's the name I'll choose. He was a friend to some, he was an uncle to others. He was a dad to me. And he was Pa to my nieces and nephews and children. And as a great-grandpa, we still call him Pa. And it's because he lived, and especially because he loved, that we're all here together. And I speak on his behalf as being the firstborn. And that's very important because if I wasn't such a perfect child, I wouldn't have had others. You all would have been here. But there's another theory that all they were doing was trying to improve on the mistake they made the first time. So I won't go into controversy about that. There's four children, 11 grandchildren, and counting our dearly adopted grandchild, Marcus, 23 great-grandchildren. So that's a total of 38 people who were here because of the love of Pa. When Pa was working in Grace Brothers in Sydney, and he was 19 years old, and Nanny was his girlfriend, he wrote her a love letter. I have that love letter in my phone, if anyone wants a copy of it. I can't remember all of it, but I do remember the PS at the end of it. It said, "I wrote this in between seeing customers. I hope it makes sense." And that little sketch that he drew of Nanny, that looks like a photograph. He did that while he was at work too, in between seeing customers. And to recapitulate his life, his great-grandmother was and Selena Morland. Why? Name was Eric Morland, but this and why Johnny's name has got Morland in it as well. I found out from other genealogists who didn't know anything about Pa that through that great grandmother of his, he was related to Sir George Morland, the landscape painter. So that may explain where he got that gene from, and I'm going to be researching that further for all of you. He was born in 1927, and they lived at Ruthven Street. His father had come from England and originally lived at Bundaberg and moved down to Sydney because he'd had a chicken farm that got flooded out. And then he went to Willara School, the same school that Johnny and Kathy and myself went to. I discussed with him about the same trees that we played under when we were at school. And he wanted to join the Air Force during World War II. He was in the Junior Air League, but he missed out on that because of his... He wanted to join the Air Force, but he missed out on it because of his eyesight. And later on, there wasn't any vacancies for that. In any case, he worked for Grace Brothers. They noticed his artistic talent and would use him for their pricing. He had sets of paint there when he was doing that. He worked for another company after Grace Brothers, but Grace Brothers called him back for a social event, and he played the piano for them. And he was a real rock star in those days because he had a piano and he could play that, and there was another band, and that happened. And then he met Mum, and they courted for about 4 years, and they were married in 1949. A couple of years after that, I came along. He started a grocery business at Alexandria, and then my godparents and him, there was a bit of a disagreement, and they parted ways. And he bought a grocery business in in Clove Valley. And we lived there from 1953 to 1959. And it was just after that my sister Catherine was born. Lorraine was born while we were at Clove Valley. I was only 3 years old at that time. And Johnny, he was born in 1960. Well, after, many, many months after Dad bought the Zephyr. So the Zephyr is older than your Uncle John. As to Pa's qualities, definitely he was placid and quietly spoken. He had a long fuse. It took a long time for him to get mad. So if I had something difficult to talk about, it's to Dad I'd talk to, not Nanny. So he was good that way. Mum could be Mum without any trouble because I had Dad for other purposes. He was approachable, and he was very humorous, and he liked to be witty, and you'd have to keep your wits about you and spar with him and trying to be funnier than him, but he'd end up being funnier than you. When Mum passed away, I came down by plane with Emily, hoping to see Mum still alive, but she passed away during the day. And I had to fly back to Brisbane on the Sunday and come back on the Monday with Mum in the Mum meaning Auntie Juanita. Anyway, we came back and I pulled up on his driveway having driven all the way back from Brisbane. And he said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "I forgot my toothbrush." And he said, "Stay there and I'll go and get it." And then just recently, last November, I told him I'm going to be staying overnight at Coffs Harbour on the way back. And he said to me, "What, is that some kind of a cough?" So I said to him, "No, it's actually Goffs Harbour. It's named after Gough Edwin." And he got that joke. He would, amidst his pain, he had two legs with ulcers and wrapped in bandages, and he was in a lot of pain. And in the midst of that, he's joking with you, right? And then there was another time when I was a teenager, I had Beethoven's Ninth Symphony played up really loud. And I said to him, "Do you know the guy who composed that was deaf?" And he said to me, "I'm sure he was." And then, and he was very truthful, but also very witty. A lady that came to the house as one of his carers, in the midst of COVID and wearing a mask, he told her that she looked better in the mask. So, and he was meticulous, he was a perfectionist. And I would proudly report, I'd tell him I passed my exams and I got 50%. He says, "That means that you only knew half your work." So I go to him sometime later, proud of myself, with 80%, and he says, "That means that 20% of your work you didn't learn." So I gave up. We may be burying past remains today, but we're not parting with everything about him. There's his legacy, and his legacy that lives on in all of us. There's little traits and characteristics that we've inherited from him. There's the memories of him. And the very fact that we actually exist at all is because he loved Nanny. And as we were growing up, in his quiet, mannered way, we knew he loved us. And we'll always have that. That will never go away. And the other is, there is always going to be that opportunity of reunion with Pa. The idea of an afterlife is not confined to religion alone. There are authors that have, there's people that have investigated the near-death experience of people and written about it. There's people like Dr. Raymond Moody, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. The Tibetan Book of the Dead is an ancient book, but it was designed to help people that were dying and give them an idea of what they were expecting. It comes up close to this modern research. And now, of all the most unlikely places, there's a discussion in quantum physics about the possibility of human consciousness existing beyond the death of the body. So it's useful to contemplate that it doesn't end with here. And in that, we are Pa's legacy. We have the possibility of doing him credit as we contemplate our own lives and do the best we can with our talents that's of service to others, coming from that love in the beginning that we got from Nanny and Pa, that we do them credit because we are a living, enduring part of their legacy. So that, I've talked myself out. Thank you.
Well, I'm sure it's, come up, Emily, as we just sit and listen to Leonard, you can see there's a love there, a bond, and that's a wonderful thing. You know, I think there's many, many people today, and particularly men, who would pay anything to have a close bond with their dad. And I don't know whether this was true for everyone, but you got something there from your dad that'll be enduring. Now, Emily, you're going to come up and say a few words, and don't worry about, look, it's a family thing today. It's good to show tears. Or not, doesn't matter. It's your love for who you're talking about, your granddad. So, come on, Emily, just take your time and share with us a few thoughts.
I asked my other cousins if they wanted to talk, but they said they, and my sister, that they didn't think they'd be able to do it. So they're with me, see if I can do it. There's one thing from a grandchild perspective is, and I'm pretty sure they'd all agree, that it really, Pa was in the background. He was behind the camera. He was in the garden. He was very quiet. And he didn't, I would say that he didn't really know what to do with little people. So, I don't know if you feel the same, but I felt, and I think a lot of us felt, that after Nan passed away, we formed that as an adult, a relationship with Pa. So for the past 17 years, he's been in the forefront and really special to us and quite funny. You could probably find him offensive if you didn't know him. If you don't have a sense of humour, you don't want him as your Pa. One of the things we all joke about when we get together and the thing that we have in common is he's always said something hilarious to us. Whether you might have painted your toenails red and he said, did you drop a brick on your toes? Why would you do that? We've all had weddings and birthday parties, and if it wasn't for our Auntie Kathy getting him and tricking him into getting to that event by, what would you do, lie to him and tell him it was 2 hours earlier, we never would have seen him. But one of the things I've noticed is that you could never leave him. If you went to visit him, he would make it very difficult for you to leave him, to the point where we would miss our flights. We would almost miss our flights because he would delay us so much that they were rushing us through check-in. It's so much so that when the funeral couldn't be held yesterday, we had to reschedule our flights again. But even from his grave, he is delaying our flights. But some of the things that he did whilst he was quiet, and he made no attempt to come to you, you had to go to him. He would have, if he noticed that you gravitated to a certain cup in the house, he would make sure that he kept that aside for you. I think for 17 years he had Nanny's favourite cup on the dish rack and never left it. He would tell us that he had, I remember you liked those Tim Tams, they were on sale, and he had maybe about 5 packets in the cupboard. The other thing I can guarantee is that we all love to get up and dance, and I feel like that's Pa. And that was one thing that I noticed that we all do, even the boys, loved getting that Eric Limpus on the dance floor. And I will miss that at our parties. I'm sorry, Uncle Johnny, he just trumped you by... So you'll have to carry that.
You can defend yourself, Johnny.
Get to defend your title. Anyway, I just hope that... I think we will. We'll have lots of things to talk about Pa. It is sad that there won't be any new things, because whilst we were visiting in the nursing home, there was new things, like when I said to him, you don't want to go out in the hallway, there's a confused lady out there at the moment. And he said to me, oh, that nutcase, there's lots of nutcases in here. And he says, I try and come into my room. And I said, and what do you do about that? And he says, I go, get out of here. Come on, get out of here. So that's the sad thing. I won't have any more funny stories to share. But we're going to miss you, Eric. Thank you.
Well, it is true. One thing that really helps at this time is to be able to share memories, to talk. I lost my youngest brother. I come from a family of 9 kids. My youngest brother, he died at 27. He knocked his ankle at work and it developed into cancer and went to his lungs and everything. But you can imagine that the shock for my mother. But one thing that Mum couldn't do was ever talk about it. And 2 years after Robert died, she got this massive dose of shingles, which is a nervous disorder. And I think it was probably related to the fact that she couldn't talk. So, it's, you know, I encourage you today, just do what Emily's done. Share your heart, talk, cry, don't cry, whatever, you know, but it's good to share. And just to be here, you know, that's part of the healing. And the thing is that in our culture today, you know, you almost expected to get over these things in an hour or something, which is ridiculous. I've spent time in Nepal, and people over there, they take a whole week, 2 weeks off work, where they just mourn and thank, you know, be thankful for the person who's passed on. So every little bit of sharing, as Emily did, and as Leonard did, it's very, very rich and good. And the relationship you have with Eric is a wonderful thing. We're going to now reflect on Eric's life as we look at some slides. Thank you. Well, I'm sure there's all sorts of memories. Does anyone want to just say in a sentence what memory you're left with today? You don't have to.
Yeah.
What's that, John? He's waving.
Yes.
Good.
It was probably an hour and a half of saying goodbye until he gave his. But even that wasn't the end. As he reversed the hour, he's still. Oh, did I? I forgot to tell you that.
Right.
Yeah, yes. So we all, everyone in the family, anyone that knows Pa knows that. Yeah. He had the longest goodbyes.
Good. So I want that to be on the video. He's a man with the longest goodbye. Thank you, John. Thanks. Very good. Well, let me just share a couple of thoughts, because, look, Leonard, rightly, you raised the whole thing about life here and the life to come. And is there a life to come? Yes, there is. I tell you, there is another life, a better life. And, Eric there, he looked so healthy and so vibrant and so handsome when he was young. And death takes its toll, doesn't it? It takes it and it reduces us. We lose things. And you think to yourself, is this all there is? Is there more to come? And I want to say to you, there is. Look, I just want to raise this question today. This is a good question. If there is more to come, how do you get there? How do you get there? And I was actually just at an event recently, and the family had brought along through another person about a dozen doves, these pure white doves. And at a certain time in the ceremony, which was one of remembrance for a person's life, they released these doves. And the birds went up in the air, they circled six times where we were, and then they took off, because they came from Kurnell over the other side of Botany Bay. And it was just incredible that these birds knew their way home. And I said to the person who brought the doves along, how do those birds know when you release them here on the northern beaches? They'll go up in the air, they'll circle round and round, they'll get their bearings and they go straight home to Kurnell, 25 minutes away as the dove flies. And then she said, look, we were once at North Head, 17 minutes from North Head, the entrance for Harbour here, straight down to Kurnell. And she said, look, I asked her, how did you teach them or train them? And she said, well, I used to take them about a kilometre away from Kurnell and then let them out, they'd fly home. Then I took them 2 kilometres, release them, they'd fly home. But somehow they could learn the way home. I thought, how remarkable. There's something built into those birds. They know where they belong and they know the way back home. And that's what I want to just raise with us now. Do we know the way home, ultimately? Now, I'll tell you their way home. Jesus said, I am the way. No one comes back to God the Father but by me. I'll tell you why Jesus is the only way. Because we all fall short. And God's a holy God. He's holy in the sense that he's different to us. He's almighty, he's eternal, he's infinite. And also the Bible tells us that God is full of love and kindness and mercy. And he's built those things into us by birth. But the fact of the matter is that none of us are what we should be. Not me, even. I knew about God from a childhood, but I lived with me at the centre. And when you look at the world, isn't it tragic? You can't think of any continent today where there isn't deep-seated conflict and where people are doing things to each other terribly. I mean, you just think of Ukraine, how a nation can be invaded. And recently, I mean, I heard some report there's about 1,500 young men have lost their lives. That was a few months ago. 1,500 families without a father, without a brother, through the selfishness of another person who has, you know, ambitions, and he's going to pursue those ambitions no matter what. And you see this selfishness everywhere. You look at the newspaper and it's alarming. You know that the way people treat each other today, the stabbings and so on? You see, the Bible says The problem with us is that as we come into the world, we put ourselves at the centre. Now, look, we know deep down we should love each other. We know that. And we have a go at it, I know. It's not all bad news. But the fundamental problem is, as far as the Bible's, the Word of God is concerned, is that we come into the world with ourselves at the centre. And so it's just another step to selfish thinking and selfish behaviour. Now, what does God think of this? Because He didn't create us that way. You see, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Now, the fantastic news is this. Jesus, the Son of God, the eternal Son of God, came amongst us. He was born. That's the Christmas story. He lived a perfect life of love for others. On the cross, because He had no sin of His own, He took your sin and my sin, and He took the consequence, which is death and separation from God. That's why Jesus on the cross, He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And having dealt with our sin, He rose and He's alive. And should you turn to Christ and recognize Him for who He is, He's the Lord. And He showed that He was the Lord by His authoritative words and His miracles. His resurrection from the dead, that is the gospel, the good news. Yes, there is someone who's defeated death, there's someone who's taken our sin. Should we turn to Him and surrender to Him forgiveness? Because He paid the price on the cross. Now, I learned that Eric's forebears had an association with the Salvation Army, and we think that maybe through that association, as Leonard shared with me, his love of music was kind of maybe aroused and stimulated. And I wanted to share this today because the Salvation Army were people back there in centuries past in England. They went out onto the streets and they gave hope to people with this same message. And you see it in the way the Salvation Army go with their business today. They care for people. They really do. And people respect them for it. But that's because of Christ, who loved us and died for us. And there's a way back home. It's through Christ. And honestly, look, I thought that the way back home could be through the good things that I could do. But the best things we do are riddled with imperfection. We all know that. You see, you need someone to take away the barrier, and that's Jesus. I'll leave you with this. I grew up in Newcastle, and for me to go back home, one way. And the one way for me to go back home is up the freeway. There's no point in going east, that will take me to New Zealand. No point going west, it'll take me to Bourke. I've got to go north. I've got to go up the freeway. And when I go up the freeway, I go back to my childhood home, my room out the back. All sorts of memories come back, just like you do today when you think of that stone home over in Bondi Junction. But the way home for me is up the freeway, because all the barriers have been removed. Now, there's a bridge over the Hawkesbury. Once upon a time, there was a punt. And there were mountains, but all the mountains have been bulldozed away, and the bridge is over the Hawkesbury. So you get on the freeway, and I'm on my way home. Now, Jesus said, I am the way. Perfect man, God amongst us, His death removed the barrier of our sin. And should we come to Him and acknowledge Him as Lord and live for Him? Forgiveness, a relationship with God. I found that when I was 18. And it's a privilege to share that with you today. So I just want to thank Len for raising this issue. There are different ideas here today, I understand. But you raise the issue of life after death. Indeed, there is. But what's the way to it? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes back to God and to that heavenly home but by me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And you can read Jesus' wonderful words in John chapter 14. So I pray that's a comfort to you today. We need comfort today. We need a word of comfort. And being with each other is very comforting. And this family knows how to share. And you're very nice people, truly, and a good family. And a legacy that came from your dad through your mum as well. But this is the ultimate comfort because, look, we all face death. We're all mortal. And we all need a solution. So let me pray. Holy and loving Father, I want to thank you, Lord, for Eric's life. I thank you, Lord, for all that he was and all that he means to the family. And I thank you today, Lord, that there are many wonderful and positive things, a legacy that he built into the family. And Lord, the fact that the extended family is here today and friends is testimony to Eric's life. And I thank you, Lord God, for those beautiful things, mainly the things about love and interest and affirmation that have come through to the family and to the extended family. And I pray, Lord, that in the weeks and months ahead, the family will be able to talk about these things, share them, and be thankful. And that, Lord, Eric's testimony will indeed live on. Almighty Father, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, Lord, I pray that you be gracious to the family today, especially, Lord God, to Leonard, Lorraine, to Kathy, and to John, and to everyone else, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that we'll be able to cast our care on you and that we might know the consolation of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Help us, Lord, to receive and understand the gospel of Jesus Christ so that we may find light in our darkness, strength in our grief, hope and comfort in your saving words. And I ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And Lord, I pray that your grace and your loving kindness will get hold of our hearts today. That, Lord, we might go away from this time together the richer for it. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we're going to have a recessional, and it's during the recessional, as we listen to, Tommy, Nathaniel. Demi, okay. We'll take the casket out. Now, as you understand, this is not Eric, it's Eric's remains. And we're going to show respect for him and for his body. We'll stand as the casket goes out, and then we'll go straight around to the Motorville Cemetery, which is not far away. And on your order of service there's words from the family you can read. But let's now just take the casket out, and we'll go out afterwards and go straight around to the cemetery, which is only 5 minutes away for the burial. So thank you for being here.